together. We are an inviting people that show love by nurturing our members and empowering them to grow spiritually in God's Word and reach out to share the good news of Jesus. Join now in our call to worship. Whether you arrived to your verse this morning or came as the service was beginning, God bids you joyful welcome. We thank you and thank God for this generous welcome. You are precious in God's sight, a delight in God's presence. Lord, we have come seeking your healing mercy. Know that God's compassionate love is poured over you this day. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Amen. Our opening hymn is Enter His Gates.
Bible study will be back. Also, our
outreach is scheduled for this Saturday, September the 26th, from 9 to 1. The CVS Pharmacy will be administering free flu shots and with your insurance card. And Bloodmobile will be accepting blood donations. Please see the church website, go to the church website to register. The drive-through meals to go will also be available to the community from 11 to 1 p.m. or until all meals are distributed. All volunteers working for the mini health fair and food giveaway, we request your presence at the church at 7:30 a.m. Join me now in our prayer of illumination. Lord, open our hearts and our minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as your scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Our first scripture reading comes from Exodus, the 16th chapter, verses 2 through 15. Listen for the word of the Lord. The whole Israelite community complained against Moses and Aaron in the desert. The Israelites said to them, "Oh, how we wish the Lord had just put us to death where we were while in the land of Egypt. There we could sit by the pots, cooking meat, and eat our fill of bread. Instead, you brought us out into this desert to starve this whole assembly to death." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I am going to make bread rain down from heaven, from the sky for you. The people will go out each day and gather just enough for that day. In this way, I will test them to see whether or not they follow my instructions. On the sixth day, when they measure out what they have collected, it will be twice as much as they collected on the other days." So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, "This evening you will know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning you will see the Lord's glorious presence, because your complaints against the Lord have been heard. Who are we? Why blame us?" Moses continued, "The Lord will give you meat to eat in the evening and your fill of bread in the morning, because the Lord heard the complaints you made against him. Who are we? Your complaints aren't against us, but against the Lord." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole Israelite community, come near to the Lord, because he's heard your complaints." As Aaron spoke to the whole Israelite community, they turned to look toward the desert, and just then, the glorious presence of the Lord appeared in the cloud. The people spoke to Moses, "I've heard complaints of the Israelites. Tell them, at twilight, you will eat meat, and in the morning, you will have your fill of bread. Then you will know that I am the Lord, your God. In the evening, a flock of quail flew down and covered the camp, and in the morning, there was a layer of dew all around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the desert surface were thin flakes as thin as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to each other, 'What is it?' They didn't know what it was. Moses said to them, 'This is the bread that the Lord has given to eat.'" Our second scripture lesson comes from Philippians, first chapter, verses 21 through 30. "Because of me, living serves Christ, and dying is even better. I continue to live in the world. I get results from my work, but I don't know what I prefer. I'm torn between two, because I want to serve this life, and be with Christ, which is far better. However, it is more important for me to stay in this world for your sake. I am sure of this. I will stay alive and remain with all of you to help your progress and the joy of your faith. And to increase your pride in Christ Jesus through my presence when I visit you again. Most important, live together in the manner worthy of Christ's gospel. Do this whether I come and see you or I am absent and hear about you. Do this that you stand firm, united in one spirit and mind as you struggle together to remain faithful to the gospel. That way, you won't be afraid of anything your enemies do. Your faithfulness and courage are a sign of their coming destruction and your salvation, which is from God. God has generously granted you the privilege not only of believing in Christ, but also of suffering for Christ's sake. You are having the same trouble you saw me face and now that I'm still facing. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Join me now in our historic confession of faith, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
blessing us in this economic downturn. And we thank you how you have saved us from each coming storm. All we can do is say, thank you, Lord. You have been better to us than we could ever be to ourselves. We ask your blessings and comfort among for those our bereaved members, Lord. Continue to wrap them with your arms of love, comfort, and peace. We ask healings for each and every person whose name you called out this morning, who we know to be ill. Lord, we just ask that you continue to bless them and strengthen their caretakers. Have mercy, Lord, on our country. Save us from the demonic plans of those who think only about power for themselves without regard to the health and well-being of those whom they serve. We ask blessings on our children and teachers who are back in school. Keep them safe from all hurt, harm, and danger. We thank you, Lord, for your continual blessing of our church. May we forever stand as a shining light of love, welcome, and caring in this community. We ask all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Our ministry of music is Amazing Grace Shall Always Be.
Oh,
text this morning comes from Matthew, the 20th chapter, the first verse going through the 16th verse. Listen for the word of the Lord. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. When he went out again about noon and 3 o'clock, he did the same thing. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around. And he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You also go into the vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last workers worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat." But he replied to one of them, "Friend, am I doing you no wrong? Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first shall be last." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Most holy and gracious God, we give you thanks for your generosity that you pour upon us daily. We thank you, Lord God, for the word that you have for us this morning. May it not return to you void, but accomplish what you set it out to do. And now, Lord God, remove me from me. Hide me beneath the cross, beneath the drippings of your precious blood. And when I speak, Lord God, let it be your voice that is heard. And when I'm seen, let it be you that is seen. May words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Let the church say, amen. First come, first serve. The early bird gets the worm. It's only fair. We will get a major attitude if we are standing in line at the grocery store or standing in line to vote and someone jumps ahead of us in line. We get upset if someone gets hired after us and gets more money than us. We believe that in seniority, and that seniority gives those with the highest seniority the benefit of earning more than those who were hired after us. First come, first serve. The early bird gets the worm. That's what we believe. Once I was at dinner with some friends, and were seated and the waitress came and took our order, we waited patiently to be served. But we noticed that people all around us who came after us were getting served, and we were still there waiting for our order. And when the waitress finally came, we asked if we could speak to the manager. And when the manager came, we explained what had happened and how people who came after us were getting served and how long we had to wait. Well, the manager understood first come, first serve, and he gave all of us our dinners for free. And then he gave us a coupon to come back for a free dinner. First come, first serve. We relished the thought that everything should be fair. We truly believe that there is privilege for those who come first. Our beliefs about being first make it difficult for us to embrace the parable of the vineyard that Jesus shares in our text. This parable goes against our belief that first come, I'll serve, and it goes against our belief in seniority. We firmly believe that those who work longer ought to get more money than those who come later, or who do not work as long as those who came first. The first will be last, and the last first doesn't make anyone who believes in first come, first serve feel better. It's hard for us to understand. It especially does not make sense to folk who have the privilege of being first. Some folk who are first don't realize that there are people who are last through no fault of their own. Like the last laborers hired in our text, some folk are idle in society because no one will hire them. Some people think that being idle is a choice until it happens to them. I used to work for the EEOC many years ago, and that is a federal agency that handles employment discrimination complaints. It used to tickle my soul when middle-aged white men would come to file a discrimination complaint because they believed that they were being discriminated against because of their age. They all used to say the same thing. I didn't think discrimination was real until it happened to me. Sometimes we in the Church Universal forget that the kingdom of heaven is not like the world, and we act like the first hired in the vineyard. We get resentful when someone new in the church gets a position. We think a new member hasn't paid their dues. A new member hasn't been here as long as we have, so why should a new member get an important position in the church? Why is a new member being honored who has only been here a few years? Folks say things like, I've been in this church all of my life. My mom and my dad were members, and so were my grandparents. This type of thinking in the church is an indication that we have let the ways of the world influence us instead of letting the kingdom of heaven influence us. If we're going to understand this parable, we have to be willing to relinquish our worldly understanding of how things should operate. We must remember that God's ways are not our ways, and God's thoughts are not our thoughts. We must realize the kingdom of heaven does not operate by our understanding of fairness. It operates by a higher divine principle of love, justice, generosity, and compassion. The parable of the vineyard that Jesus shares in our text helps us to see that these higher divine, to see in action. As we think about the parable of the vineyard, it teaches us what it really means to participate in the kingdom of heaven. First, it teaches us that just as the vineyard belongs to the vineyard owner, the church belongs to God, not us. So those of us in the church can ill afford to let God's influence in our life and in the church be overshadowed by the ways of the world. Second, the parable teaches us that God is sovereign. God can do whatever God wants to do. God has decided that in the kingdom of heaven and in God's church, there will be no first come, first serve. There will be no seniority. Why? Because that is what God wants. It is God's vision for God's people that all are treated the same. There is no meritocracy in the kingdom of heaven. Third, we learn from this parable that all are invited to be a part of the kingdom of heaven. God actively seeks out people to invite in God's kingdom. All who accept God's invitation receive salvation in Jesus' name and eternal life. All who accept God's invitation are treated the same. Whether we have been serving God early in the morning or we just started serving God in the evening, we all get the same reward. Parents with more than one child can better understand why God chooses to reward all of us the same. Parents with more than one child will never tell their second or third child, "I can't provide for you like I do your older brother because you came last." None of us would do that. Good parents love and care for their children, not other children, not just the oldest. That's the way it is with God. God cares for all of God's children. God wants all of us to share in God's blessing. Here is the thing. If we keep on looking at the world through the lens of what we can be consider to be fair instead of through the lens of God's generosity, we will miss the real blessing of being first. Those who are hired first in the parable couldn't see that working all day meant that they didn't have to worry about how they would provide for their families. Instead of being resentful, those who work all day long should have been rejoicing that they had been hired early. We are Christians, and if we love our neighbors as ourselves, we should want our neighbors to have what we have. If we have experienced the goodness of the Lord in our lives, why would we deny the same goodness for someone else? God has enough blessings for everyone. I have shared this story with you before, but it bears repeating. There was a leaf worker in Africa who organized a race for children. The winner of the race would receive a basket full of fruit. To the worker's surprise, the children each held each other's hand, and they all ran across the finish line together. When the relief worker asked them why they did that, they said because if one person got the prize, they would not be able to enjoy it knowing that others in the race had nothing. This way they could all enjoy the prize together. My brothers and my sisters, how can we enjoy the blessing of God's generosity knowing that there are others who have nothing at all? The good news is this. Our generous God has enough for all of us. The generosity of God is not just to give up, given to us because we are so good or because we are first. God's generosity is given to us because God is so good. There is no time in our lives that God is showering us with grace and blessings. I don't know about you, I'm glad that God is generous. I'm so glad that as soon as we are accepted, as soon as we accept the gracious invitation to be a part of God's kingdom and to follow Jesus, that we are received until the kingdom of heaven. That is good news. Think for a moment about the thief on the cross. He asked Jesus, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus didn't say, "Okay, as soon as you complete your 6-month probation and you pay your dues, you can be with me in paradise." No, Jesus said, "This day you shall be with me in paradise." When Jesus made this promise to the thief, the disciples didn't say, "That's not fair. We've been following you for 3 years. Why should this thief be with us in paradise?" Instead, the disciples remembered what Jesus said to the thief on the cross and passed it on to us so that we can understand that it doesn't matter how long we've been with Jesus. It just matters that we are with Jesus. We can rejoice in the knowledge that God is not fair. God is generous. If God was fair instead of generous, where would any of us be? If God were fair instead of generous, many of us would have been struck by lightning by now. Where would any of us be if it were not for God's love, compassion, justice, grace, mercy, and generosity? Because God is so good, we can all participate in God's kingdom. Every time we turn around, God is blessing us. He is blessing us in this pandemic. He is blessing us in this economic downturn. And he has blessed us from all the storms. And he has saved us from all the storms that have come our way. So don't be resentful about what God does for others. Be grateful that God is still blessing you. Instead of worrying about those who have only been serving for a little while, get position and recognition. Be grateful that you have had more time to serve and enjoy Jesus. If you've been working for Jesus a long time, you can say with all the saints, "I've been working for Jesus a long time and I'm not tired yet. I've been running by day and praying by night and I'm not tired yet." My brothers and sisters, keep on believing, keep on working, keep on praying, because our generous God is still blessing you. Let the church say amen. It is that time in our service when we invite those looking for a fellowship to come and join us here at Hartsdale Mount Zion Church. You can come on membership transfer. You can come on profession of faith. All you need is a desire to get to know Jesus, or if you already know Jesus and want to, and looking for a fellowship, now is your time. Simply inbox me It is now that time in our service where we give back to God just a portion of what God has blessed us with. Our offertory scripture comes from 2 Corinthians, the 9th chapter and the 7th verse. Will you read it with me, please? Each one of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Let us pray. Lord God, we bring our tithes and offerings to you today, cheerfully, and we pray, Lord, that you bless all of those who give. In Jesus' name, we pray. You may pay your tithes and offerings at the drive-through offering from 11:15 to 12, or you may put them in the mail, or you can go on our website, www.heartsalemountainzion.org, and hit the donate button and pay that way. We are asking that everyone contribute to hurricane relief, and that if you haven't done so, that you begin to pay your anniversary askings, which is $51 per member. We'll now hear our offertory selection, Emmanuel. control, empowered by the Holy Spirit, knowing that whatever